the triumphal entry.
Okay, yeah.
Okay. Good morning. Happy Palm Sunday, everyone. So in honor of Palm Sunday, if you would, find your places and then rise at the hearing of God's word. But in honor of Palm Sunday, even though this isn't our main text this morning, I'm going to read from Matthew 21, and it's the triumphal entry. And so this is what this day commemorates, Jesus coming into Jerusalem to be crucified. So Matthew 21, verse 1. Now when they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethpage, the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go into the village in front of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, the Lord needs them, and he will send them at once. This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden. The disciples went and did as Jesus directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put on them their cloaks, and he sat on them. Most of the crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. And the crowds that went before him and followed him were shouting, Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest! And when he had entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up, saying, who is this? And the crowd said, this is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for what this day represents, Palm Sunday, the day that you willingly went to Jerusalem, knowing that by Friday you would be lifted up on the cross, dying for our sins. And Lord, that's where all of our hope lies, that you were crucified for our sins, taking on our penalty and our shame. And on that following Sunday, Lord, that you were raised from the dead, conquering sin and death. And Lord, and that is why we gathered here this morning, praising your name, lifting you up, because we believe that you are the Son of, that Jesus was the Son of God, and he died for our sins and was raised to life. And Lord, just let us this morning just, you know, have the right mind and heart, prepare our hearts this morning, Lord, just to sing your praise and to lift you up and to be genuine in all that we do. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, Split Log. We are so happy to have you here with us this morning, and happy Palm Sunday, as Trent said. If you look at the seat back in front of you, you will see a Connect card. We would love for you to fill this out and drop it in the offering bucket as it comes by. I hope you are able to grab a bulletin so we can go through some announcements. There is a baby shower table out in the foyer for Rachel and Ethan Epperson. They are having a baby boy. We are having a blood drive. There's a little insert in your bulletin. We're having a blood drive on Thursday afternoon. We would love for you guys to come to that and support that. There is Bible study tonight at 6 p.m., but next week is Easter, so we will not be having a deacon's meeting or a prayer service, as the bulletin says. That's wrong. That's moving to the next week. And I think that, oh, nope, Easter eggs. We are going to have an Easter egg hunt after church next Sunday. If you want to volunteer to help fill eggs, we have candy, we just need to fill them. That we'll be doing that Wednesday. Before? During and after. Okay. Anyway, if you have any questions, you can see April Mokul on that. I think that's everything. If you have any questions, you can always contact the office. And I think that's everything. Okay, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I just praise you for what today means, and that we can just praise you for that, Lord. I pray that you would just open our hearts and our ears for what you have for us this morning. I pray that you would just use the worship team and Trent this morning, and just as your vessel, we give you all the praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, everybody.
I was not aware it was Palm Sunday, so my music will not reflect it. So if you want to get to your feet, welcome each other to church. I will sing forever of your love. Come down with my hands to heaven. Shout your praises loud. I was lost in darkness when you pulled me out. I will sing forever of your love. Come down. I once was blind, I could not see. Chains of sin had shackled me. God in heaven heard my plea. Jesus, Jesus, rescued me. Jesus, Jesus, rescued me. I will sing forever of your love. Come down with my hands to heaven. Shout your praises loud. I was lost in darkness when you pulled me out. I will sing forever of your love. Come now, grace so sweet, it floods my soul. Hope eternal won't let go. My daily race at Calvary. Jesus, Jesus, rescue me. Jesus, Jesus, rescue me. And I will sing forever of your love. Come down with my hands to heaven, shout your praises loud. I was lost in darkness when you pulled me out. I will sing forever of your love. Well, there's a hope beyond the sky. A song we'll sing for all of time. The grave is empty and I am free. Jesus, Jesus, rescue me. Yes, Jesus, Jesus, rescue me. And I will sing forever of your love. Come down with my hands to heaven. Shout your praises loud. I was lost in darkness when you pulled me out. I will sing forever. forever of your love come down. I will sing forever of your love come down. With my hands to heaven, shout your praises loud. I was lost in darkness when you pulled me out. I will sing forever of your love come down. I will sing forever of your love come down. I will sing forever of your love come down.
Thank you. I sing. Praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come.
Feel free to use this time to take care of business. The altar's always open. Your seat, anything will work, but just do what needs to be done.
Opportunity to worship you through the reading and discussing of your word, and God, through song and through serving and through giving and all the ways that we're going to be able to do that together today. We thank you for the promises that you have spoken over us, and God, the blood that your son shared for us. And just as we enter into this holy week, God, we pray that those things would be on our mind and in our hearts. Lord, we just thank you for the promise that we are yours and you are ours forevermore. Be with Trent as he brings your word today.
And God, give us open hearts and eyes and ears to hear what you have for us today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning again, and happy Palm Sunday. A couple announcements before we get before we dismiss the kids. Blood drive. Just want to continually remind you. It's this Thursday from 2 to 6. And if you can remember, sign up in the foyer after service today. I'll try to remind you again before you leave. And also, we have an upcoming work day that the deacons are putting together. Just doing things that need to be done around the church. And that will be in a couple weeks, not next week. Next week is Easter, but it will be the following week, which is April 16th. And we could also use your help. If you see things around the church that that needs to be taken care of, sometimes we miss those things and they get overlooked. So if you see something that needs attention, if you would report that to Dan Bradford, and I would make him stand up, but he's not here. And if you don't know who Dan Bradford is, you can just find anyone else in the church. You can come tell me, you can call me, you can come to the office or see any of the deacons or any of the elders, and we'll just try to get those things taken care of. Okay, so with that, kids are dismissed. And along with the teachers and the volunteers. And for the rest of you, though, I've kind of mentioned Palm Sunday a few times. And some of you may wonder, like, hey, I don't really know exactly what Palm Sunday is. And so I'm just going to kind of give you a rundown. So Palm Sunday is, remember where we've been at in the gospel of, Luke. And what is Jesus doing? He is making his way to Jerusalem. And why is he going to Jerusalem? Well, he's going there to be crucified for our sins. And Palm Sunday is just the beginning of what we call Holy Week, the week that Jesus goes to the cross. And this day, Palm Sunday, commemorates the triumphal entry, which is what I read from opening up the service this morning. And so Jesus, he finally makes it to Jerusalem, and he's coming in, and he's riding on a donkey. And you go, okay, like, why do you even throw that detail in there? What's the importance of a donkey? Seems like good transportation in the first century. But the donkey was very important. It was actually, Jesus was fulfilling prophecy. So Zechariah 9:9 says this: "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. Righteous and having salvation is he. Humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." So Jesus coming into Jerusalem riding on a donkey was a big deal. It was Jesus saying, "I'm the king and I'm here. You've been waiting for me for a long time and I'm here." And many people were also there, ready as Jesus was coming in, and they were waving palm branches, hence the name Palm Sunday. And palm branches, they symbolized triumph and victory. And they were also shouting, "Hosanna," which is a cry, a plea for salvation. So they were saying, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." And many things take place from now until Friday. But on Friday, what happens? Jesus is crucified, and obviously on the following Sunday, he is raised from the dead. And so that is what we're celebrating. And sometimes it's okay if you didn't know that. You're not a bad Christian. It's totally fine. The thief on the cross that my small group looked at this morning, he probably had no idea that the Palm Sunday was going to be a thing, and he's in heaven with Jesus. So it's okay if you don't know what that means, but that's what it means. Now let's go to the Lord in prayer before we get really started. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for what this day means to us, just that you willingly came into Jerusalem. You didn't want to go to the cross, but you wanted to do the will of the Father. And you loved us enough to willingly lay down your life for us. And Lord, we thank you for making that sacrifice, because through that sacrifice, we find life in you. And Lord, so we just lift you up. We glorify you. We exalt you this morning. As we look into your word, give us eyes to see and give us ears to hear. And let your spirit convict us where we need conviction, and help us apply the words of your words to our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. So the rest of you, if you want to open up to Luke 11, we're going to be beginning in verse 37. And so, again, you know, Jesus, you know, he comes into Jerusalem on this day, right, Palm Sunday. And guess who is also there besides the people waving the palm branches? The Pharisees. They're there. And they absolutely hate the fact that this is happening. They despise Jesus for this. And Jesus has had many, many run-ins with the Pharisees. And today we get to look at another one of these events today. So, you know, this passage this morning is filled with many, many woes. And not like the cool woes, like, whoa, that's so cool. You know, like those are the woes that I like. But these are like bad woes, like, whoa, I am in serious trouble, you know. So let me just paint you a little picture. Imagine that we went out and, you know, at a church, you know, we voted on this, you know, we went out and we bought a great big sign. And we put it out by the stop sign out there. You know, that's a really good place. You know, it's like three-way intersection there. A lot of people are going to see this sign. And what are we going to put on the sign? Well, we're going to put on, woe to you. And as people who do not come to church here, as they drive by and they see this sign, they're going to be like, I guess they're talking to me. You know, I'm not a regular church goer, you know, and they're like, I'm definitely not going to go to that church because they seem a little mean. They seem a little harsh. But in reality, the sign is not meant for them as much as it is meant for us. It would be meant for the people who regularly attend the church. As they drive in to the parking lot, they would see the sign and they go, woe to you. Woe to you. You know, it's not like, how dare you for not being in church, you outsiders. And then, you know, you guys all funnel in here and I'm like, see, I'm so glad you're not like the rest of the world. Like you got your act together. You guys are good. They're bad. You know, that's not what the sign would be used for. So that's actually, so this kind of scenario where the woe would be to the church here, this is kind of what's happening in the passage that we're going to look at today. Jesus, you know, it would be like, to paint it, to maybe make it even stronger illustration, it would be like Jesus, if he was here today, you know, in the flesh, and he came strolling in the doors, he would probably first and foremost point straight at me and say, woe to you. And then he would turn around and he would say, and woe to all of you. Why? Because in this passage, Jesus is speaking not to pagans, but to Jewish people, specifically to the religious leaders, the religious and the very pious people of that day. So this message is very much for us, you know, the religious people. And we would be foolish not to hear and to heed the warning of Jesus in this passage. And I'm not at all saying that we are Pharisees. If you trusted in Christ, you are a new creation saved by the grace of God. You have the Holy Spirit dwelling in you, leading you into righteousness. So if you're a Christian, you should be moving away from kind of being like a Pharisee and more to becoming more like Christ. That's That's our reality of what it means to be in Christ. That's what happens. It's the sanctification that happens within us. But we must admit that on this side of heaven, we are not yet perfect. And within our, that there is this war raging between the spirit and our flesh. And within our flesh rises up these Pharisaical type tendencies, right? We struggle with some of the same things that the Pharisees struggled with. We get really wrapped up in our religious practices and traditions, and we neglect actual justice and actual righteousness. And we reject genuine love for God and for our neighbors. This morning, actually, we were receiving the praise team meets in the morning. They get here early, they practice, but we always have a time of prayer before. And someone shared a prayer request about someone who's not a believer right now. They're not following Christ. And someone mentioned, it's really easy to hear a prayer request about somebody who we don't really know, who is not a believer, and to be moved to compassion. Because we don't know that. And but really, what other purpose do we have if it's not to bring this message of salvation to people just like that person, to the lost people? We exist, one, because Christ died for us and made us his holy church, but we exist for also a mission to be his spokespeople, right? His representatives in the world, leading people to Jesus, his ambassadors. So, we can get wrapped up in just coming to church and doing all of these regular, normal Christian things and actually kind of neglect the things that we're actually called to do. Like go and tell people about Jesus and really have a genuine love for our neighbor and a genuine love for God. And so this message is very much for us today. And we can, listen to this. This is probably maybe the most important thing I think I'm going to say today, is that we can look at the scriptures and we can admit that at times we fall into these same types of failures that the Pharisees did. We can honestly admit these things. And it doesn't mean that you're not a Christian. It just means that God still has more work to do in you. He's got more work to do in conforming you to become more and more like Jesus. And that is okay. It's good to feel conviction because that means that God is still actively present and he is at work in your life. And it is right for us to recognize that on this side of heaven, we will never be perfect. And there's always going to be more work for us to do. There's always going to be things that God needs to reveal in our hearts. And there's always going to be things that we're going to fail at. We're going to continue to fall short. And we're going to have to lay these things down at the feet of Jesus, where we find forgiveness and he restores us. So let us be a people who welcomes the conviction of the Holy Spirit, right? Let us not, be so afraid of admitting our flaws and our failures, because if we do, if we're so afraid of that, then we have the temptation to just hide those things away, to cover them up, and to not really ever deal with them. But if we welcome conviction, and we confess our sins and we bring them before Jesus, then we're letting the Holy Spirit take hold of the things in our lives and change those things and begin to transform those things in us. And so let that be working in us as we look at the woes given to the Pharisees, instead of just saying, well, I'm not like them, I'm in Christ, be like, no, how do I see myself in this passage? What is the Lord trying to reveal to me? And so Jesus, in this passage, he's speaking a message of warning about pending judgment to those who neglect the word of God. And also, he's saying woes to people who are burdening people with false teaching. And I myself take this extremely seriously since I do so much teaching. The two main groups that of people that we see this morning are the Pharisees and the lawyers. Okay, so Pharisees, just as a refresher, Pharisees are religious leaders of that day, teachers of the law. They tried very, very hard. They attempted night and day, as hard as they possibly could, to fulfill the basic requirements of the law so that they could be holy to the Lord. And on the outside, you look at them and you go, that's pretty good. Like, that's a good thing. You know, good for them. They're doing pretty well. But here's the problem. They truly thought that they were completely fulfilling the law and that before God, they were justified, that they were righteous. And that was their first mistake. Their second mistake is that they greatly desired status and praise and admiration from people, right? They really cared deeply about appearing holy to people, right? And while many of these, many of the things that they did was in fact required by God, they also had a lot of other laws and rules. I shouldn't say laws, rules, but they considered them to be laws that were entirely man-made. And the purposes of these rules were, you know, say God's law is right here, right? They would put these rules around God's law as like a protective hedge. And so you wouldn't, if as long as you don't pass over that hedge, you're far less likely to actually break the law of God. And so they add to the law saying, hey, go above and beyond what the law requires and also go the extra mile and avoid at all costs even coming close to breaking the law. And there's not necessarily anything wrong with taking precautions and saying, you know what, like, this is an area that I struggle with. Like, the law says don't do this, and I really want to do that, so I need to kind of put some barriers in place to make sure that I'm not tempted into breaking that law. But here's where the Pharisees messed up. They elevated these hedges to be equal with the law of God. And so when people crossed over the hedge, they broke their rules, they condemned them and said, you have broken the law of God. And so they were making it very, very difficult for the people to follow the Lord. They were adding extra burdens and putting extra burdens on them. So that's the Pharisees. The lawyers, on the other hand, they were people who would interpret the law of God, but they would also add in these extra rules, right? They would write these man-made rules in. And not only that, but they would write in these special little loopholes so that they themselves did not have to be as strict as they were instructing the people to be. You know, so like when they messed up, they would just find a little loophole and justify themselves from like, I didn't actually break the law. You see, here's why, you know, this saves me from actually breaking that. And they were making it harder for other people without actually making it harder for themselves. And so you have a completely works-based system of earned righteousness, which is exactly what the old covenant was. If you were going to earn eternal life through the law, you were going to have to fulfill it perfectly. Past, present, future. Like, you could never mess up, which is impossible. And is exactly why Jesus had to come. This is exactly why Jesus had to come to Jerusalem riding in on a donkey, so that on Friday he would be put to death, becoming our perfect sacrifice for the forgiveness of our sins, so that we may have eternal life, not through the law, but through Jesus. And so going back to the Pharisees and the lawyers, what their problem was in a nutshell was that they suffered from legalism. And if you don't think that Christians are tempted to be legalists, then either you haven't been around for very long or you haven't been paying attention. Because legalism has been around, has been a threat to the church ever since it began. Just go and read any of Paul's letters, and he will fight you tooth and nail about how Christians have been freed from the condemnation of the law and that we now live to Christ. We don't follow a certain set of rules to earn salvation. No, but instead we are led by the Holy Spirit into righteousness as we lay our lives down before Christ, who is our life. Salvation is found only in him. So what does legalism do? And why is it so dangerous and deadly? It obsesses over the external appearance, right? Presenting a fake appearance of righteousness while neglecting the internal wickedness of the heart. And it actually hinders people from following God. And we're going to see all those things as we break down the text today. So beginning in verse 37, while Jesus was speaking, a Pharisee asked him to dine with him. So he went in and reclined at table. The Pharisee was astonished to see that he did not first wash before dinner. So when we're invited over to someone's house for dinner, I think we can all agree that there are just some basic expectations. You should show up, one. You should be polite and courteous to the host. And probably most importantly, you do not insult the host. You absolutely do not insult the host. They are being kind. They're letting you into their house, and they're serving you their food. Well, Jesus is not your traditional house guest. When he's invited over to this Pharisee's house for dinner, Jesus immediately insults the Pharisee. And now Jesus has purpose for all of this. He's, in fact, teaching this Pharisee a very, very important lesson. So Jesus isn't just being a jerk for the sake of it. He has a purpose for what he is doing. And so what did he do that was so insulting that the Pharisee was astonished? Like, he was like, oh, he breaks a well-known tradition that he knew would upset the Pharisee. He doesn't wash his hands before dinner. And why is this so insulting? Why is the Pharisee so astonished? Because, I mean, like, Jesus, just wash your hands. Like, that seems like a wise thing to do. Like, you've been out and about, and I know you like to touch sick people, and you probably got some germs on your hands, right? I've seen you touch dead bodies and raise them to life and all these other things. I mean, you got some germs. But this has nothing to do with germs. But actually, this hand washing, I mean, they didn't even use like soap or anything. I mean, they just literally, this is what the ritual consisted of. They had a big old pot of water, and they would just dip their hands. That's it. Like, and if you know anything, if you've ever gone through the hand washing class and they put the stuff on your hands, And if you don't wash your hands with soap and water and rinse them off really, really well, and then they put a black light under it, you're going to see there's still all this junk on your hands, you know? So, I mean, doing a dip isn't going to take any germs off. So this has nothing to do with that, but it has entirely to do with this man-made spiritual ritual of cleansing. And like I said, so man-made, so Jesus did not at all break the law of God, but the Pharisees, because this is what they do, they've exalted this man-made rule to be equal with God's law, and they considered this to be an essential ritual, an essential thing for a teacher of God to do. And they know that Jesus claims to be a teacher of God. He claims to be more than that, but they often just refer to him as teacher. But Jesus, he knows what's going on in this man's heart, right? Like, he knows what how he thinks about things. And so he's going to do this in order to get to a deeper matter. Jesus takes this opportunity to show them that they've completely missed the point of God's law. They've missed the heart. And so continuing on, verse 39, and the Lord said to him, now you Pharisees, cleanse the outside of the cup and of the dish, but inside you are full of greed and wickedness. And so even though the Pharisees, they seemingly do everything right, the even going above and beyond what the law required of them, and they did all these things in order to make sure that they never break the rules and so that people think well of them. And Jesus, he still calls them out. Jesus, he points out that on externally, you guys look great. To the naked eye, you guys look amazing. But on the inside, you know, your cup, your dish, it's filthy. It's disgusting. The outside of the cup is spotless, but inside your heart, it is filthy. It's full of greed. It's full of wickedness. And that is what legalism does. It obsesses over the outer appearance while neglecting what's inside the heart. Neglecting what's actually within and what actually needs to be dealt with. And so imagine someone invites you to go golfing. And I don't think we have very many golfers here, because if we do, then shame on you for not inviting me. Because I like to golf. But imagine someone says, hey, let's go golfing. And you don't golf, but you accept the invite and you're like, okay, but I got to go buy some stuff. So you go to Academy, right? And you get decked out, you know, head to toe in like Callaway apparel, right? High dollar stuff. And you get custom fitted clubs. You know, I'm 5'9", so my clubs are short. And you get custom fitted clubs and all this stuff. And you look like a professional. You look like you should be on the PGA Tour. And you go out and, you go out on the golf course and you're up on the tee box and you look amazing. And everyone's like, man, that guy's such a good golfer. Like, he's so invested. Look at everything that he has. But you got a secret. You have no idea how to swing a golf club. Nothing at all. So even though you look like you should be on the pro tour, when you get on the course, you're actually going to be exposed. This fake facade is going to be revealed, and you're going to spend most of your time hitting balls out of the woods than playing in the fairway. And everyone is going to be like, who does this guy think he is? Who is he fooling? Nobody. He's a terrible golfer. And that wasn't about me, right? Like, I'm a good golfer. So if you want to take me, you should take me. I won't slow you down, I promise. No, I'm really not that good. I'm not good. I'm just kidding. So essentially, right, the Pharisees, they're fooling everyone, right? They're fooling everyone into believing that they were really, really holy and really, really righteous. And the sad part is, unlike this golfer, they are really good at playing the part. And they actually did fool a lot of people. And they actually fooled themselves. But really, while they looked good on the outside, really they were dead on the inside. But they didn't care. They were satisfied with the outer appearance. And we're tempted to do the exact same things. We're tempted to show up here and we're tempted to put on our best Christian face, right? Our best Christian appearance. And you're like, I don't want anyone to see what's really going on in my heart. I don't want you to see that I've been greedy and I've failed this week and I've acted wickedly. You know, I've been golfing out of the rough more than the fairway all week long. But as far as you know, I've only been playing in the fairway. I'm really, really good. I've been doing great. I don't want to share my failures. I don't want to share my struggles because I want you to think well of me. Or at the very least, we don't want people to think poorly of us. But listen, you can't fool God. You can fool people. You can't fool God. He knows, he sees and he knows what's in the heart. And God doesn't want us to really even be concerned about impressing people. What he wants is for your heart to be concerned and focused on doing the things that please him and loving him, like genuinely, fully, with all of your heart. That's what he wants you to care about. He wants you to care about what's on the inside. And does God care about the outside too? Of course he does. Of course he does. He created both. He created the inside and the outside. But often we get these things backwards. We go, okay, if my inside is all messed up, it's all jacked up, but first I need to clean up all the things on the outside before I can even begin addressing the things that are on the inside. You know, it's this whole idea that I know you've heard this before. Well, I'll go to church when I get, you know, my life kind of cleaned up, you know. I gotta take care of a few things before I actually step foot in a church, right? But the thing is, you're never actually going to fix the problem, even if you do, you know, through just sheer discipline, fix a few of these external things. The inside is still unfixed. And it's just also just a backwards thinking, because this is not the instruction of Jesus. Let us look at the instruction of Jesus. Verse 40, you fools, did he who made the outside make the inside also? But give as alms those things that are within, and behold, everything is clean for you. But woe to you, Pharisees, for you tithe mint and rue and every herb and neglect justice and the love of God. These you ought to have done without neglecting the others. Woe to you, Pharisees, for you love the best seats in the synagogues and greetings in the marketplaces. And so Jesus is saying, of course, I'm concerned about the outside, but I'm also concerned about the inside. I made both of them. I want the inside of the dish to be cleaned as well as the outside of the dish. But to clean the outside, you first got to clean up the inside. Spiritual cleanliness works from the inside out, not from the outside in. But instead of taking this out, you know, this inside out approach, the Pharisees, again, they take the outside in approach. And they tithe to the point that was almost ridiculous. They would take all of their herbs and their spices, and they would lay them out and take a tenth of them, you know, and offer it up to God. And that was more than what the law required. And Jesus, he goes, you know, you can tithe as much as you want. Nobody's stopping you from tithing more. But you should have done those things. You should have tithed without neglecting these other things, like the love of God and a desire for justice, a love for justice. God wants us to care for other people. He doesn't want us to care about what people think about us. He wants us to be generous towards people. He wants us to take care of the poor and the marginalized. He says, if you really want to be holy and righteous, then give from within. Stop being self-centered and be others-focused. Stop being greedy and wicked. Instead, live sacrificially. Be generous. Stop neglecting the needs of the poor, the defenseless, the hungry. That's what true spiritual holiness and righteousness ought to look like. And he's like, but you guys are so far away from this. Like, woe to you. And so again, as we go through this, it is, again, it's okay to admit our failures. It's okay to say, you know what, I have not been living the way I ought. I have been greedy. I have been acting wickedly. And I haven't been spending time with God. I've been all wrapped up in myself. I've been very self-centered. I haven't been caring about people. Because the truth is, we all fall short. Every single one of us, we all fall short. But then that's where the great news of the gospel comes in. If you trust in Christ, you don't have to worry about earning your way into heaven. If you mess up, you don't have to try to cover it up and find a loophole like the Pharisees and the lawyers would have done. You can just freely admit these things to Jesus. And he's like, I know, that's what I died for. It's covered. It's already covered by my blood, but thank you for laying that down. That was the right thing. Now I can work in you. Now I can begin healing you and fixing you. Let's work these things out together. And then the Spirit comes in, you know, already in us, obviously, but it just fills us up and it's just like getting at work in us and we're just following the Lord. And that's when you actually have this relationship, this communion with God, not when you're hiding sins, but when you're so open about them. I'm a failure, God. I'm so weak. Use me. So if you haven't been doing, you know, all these things all that well, you know, you've been failing. You look at yourself, you look at your life, you do some self-examination over the past, you know, a few weeks, past month or whatever, and you're like, I am really, really flawed. I'm not in a good place. That's great. That's great that you recognize that. Because that's what God's word does. It exposes sin to us. And then the message of the gospel reminds us, just lay those things down at the cross. Repent, surrender your failures, and let God begin to change you from the inside out. And so if as we do that, as we lay these things down, and God works on our hearts and the motivations why we do things and transforms our mind, then our outer actions are going to follow these things. It's going to be apparent that God's at work in us. And so you don't have to fake it. It's going to be genuine. Isn't that the dream? Like doing the things that we know that we ought to be doing, but not out of a sense of duty, but just because we genuinely desire to do these things. We genuinely desire to be holy because we know, like we want to be like Jesus. We want to follow him and all that he has done. That's what I want. I want my Christian walk to be genuine, to be real. Because it is such a burden. It is so exhausting and tiring to fake these things. Verse 43, woe to you Pharisees, for you love the best seat in the synagogues and greetings in the marketplaces. And so what did Jesus say that they were ought to love? They were ought to love God, but they neglected God. They neglected loving God. And instead, what do they love? They loved the best seats in the synagogues. And they loved the greetings in the marketplaces. In other words, they loved status and they loved praise. And this leads me to ask the next question for us this morning. What is our motivation for the things that we do? Why do we serve? Do we do it so that people will see us and recognize us and think, wow, they're so cool, they're so good, and then to praise us? And you go, well, no, of course not. Of course I don't do things for praise. But then, you know, you serve for a while, and then people don't seem to appreciate you. They're not praising you, and you get upset. But how can we get upset about people not, you know, appreciating us or praising us if we claim to be serving solely for the love of God? So that is where, you know, the problem is revealed to us. It doesn't make any sense. This reveals that our motivations are wrong. There's still work that needs to be done on the inside. And I'm not saying that we shouldn't appreciate people. That's absolutely not what I'm saying. Like, if you see someone like working in the kitchen or whatever, like doing all these things, like give them a thanks. You know what I mean? Like, be appreciative, be a thankful people, be a kind people. Recognize the things that people are doing for you is actually God serving you. So not only thank the people, but thank the Lord. You know, be a thankful and appreciative people. But the point is that so many people will begin serving God they'll begin serving, but then they'll quit simply because, you know, they're not getting what they want from man. Right? They're serving for God, but they quit because of man. And in that lies the error. We ought to serve God regardless of what people think of us. Lay down the desire for status and praise. Just lay that down. It all belongs to Jesus. All status, all praise belongs to Jesus anyways. It's not about you. It's not about me. It's surely not about me. If you, shame on you. If you, like, if I was to add a woe, I would say, woe to you if you think, if you put me on a pedestal. I know it's hard to say since I'm literally up here, higher. But if you put me on a pedestal, then woe to you. Do not follow me. Follow Jesus. If I leave tomorrow, are you still going to come next Sunday to come and worship the Lord? You should. It's do not follow leaders. Follow the leader. All these other pastors, we're under shepherds. And so we often don't know what we're doing. I am so often found in a spot trying to serve, you know, leading the church. And I'm like, I don't know. And so if you think like, oh, Trent's our fearless leader, you're wrong. I wouldn't put any hope in me. And so moving on. Verse 44, woe to you, for you are like unmarked graves, and people walk over them without knowing it. So in the Old Testament, to touch a body or to touch a grave or to walk over them, it would make a person legally unclean for 7 days. And so, you know, they didn't want anyone to be unclean by accident, you know, because the grave was unmarked. So they would mark the graves. They would make it very apparent, like, this is a grave. And what Jesus is doing is he's saying, you Pharisees, you are not only leading people astray, you are not only leading people to things that actually defile that person and make that person unclean, but you are the very thing that is defiling them and making them unclean. You are unmarked, or rather, perhaps mismarked. They appear to be holy. They appear to be righteous, but in reality, by following them, they become, you know, as people follow the Pharisees, they become more and more like the Pharisees because you become like the ones you follow. And so again, if you follow after me, you're going to be sorely disappointed. But if you follow after Jesus, then you're on the right track. Track. That came out weird. And so these people, you know, they were following after the Pharisees and they were becoming more like the Pharisees. But Jesus says, the Pharisees they're getting it all wrong. You're going further away from God. You're actually becoming more unclean and more unholy. And so legalism in the pursuit of trying to earn their way to God, legalism actually hinders people from having a relationship with God because they were legalists. Like, hey, come do what I do. Be like me. Buy into my legalism. They wouldn't say that, but that's basically what they're doing. And they were not actually having a genuine relationship with God. Verse 45, one of the lawyers answered him, teacher, in saying these things, you insult us also. I love this. Verse 46, and he said, woe to you lawyers also. For you load people with burdens hard to bear, and you yourselves do not touch the burdens with one of your fingers. And so what's happening? One of the lawyers, one of the interpreters of the law, says to Jesus, hey, Jesus, you've insulted us as well. In other words, Jesus, like, you hurt our feelings, man. And Jesus is like, yeah, I know. I said it loud enough for you to hear too. And he's like, actually, I got more things to say to you, things that are specifically for you guys. And at this point, if you're the lawyer, you're wishing you kept your mouth shut. Because Jesus, he doesn't let up at all. He's got serious, serious problems with both of these groups of people because they're being so harmful to others, leading them astray, making it harder for them to follow God. And so how are the lawyers specifically harming people? Well, if you're a Jewish person and you're like, hey, I need to know what the law says about this certain thing, you would go to the lawyer, right? That makes sense. But again, they added things to the law, and they made the law, which was already impossible to fulfill, to keep, and they made it even more difficult. So the law in and of itself is already an impossible burden, and they're just like, here, take some more burdens, you know? Like, you know, not only should you do this, but, you know, what the oral tradition says, and which we've written down, says you also need to be doing these things. And it's like, what? So this made it incredibly difficult. And then, you know, not only that, but they would write in the little loopholes so that they would be excluded from these things that they were teaching. And so the lawyers were just straight up misrepresenting God. And Jesus, who is God in the flesh, he's standing right there. He hates it. Verse 47, woe to you, for you build the tombs of the prophets whom your fathers killed. So you are witnesses and you consent to the deeds of your fathers, for they killed them and you build their tombs. Therefore also the wisdom of God said, I will send them prophets and apostles, some of whom they will kill and persecute, so that the blood of all the prophets shed from the foundation of the world may be charged against this generation, from the blood of Abel to the blood of Zechariah, who perished between the altar and the sanctuary. Yes, I tell you, it will be required of this generation. And so what is Jesus saying? He's saying all the blood that was, you know, that was shed by the prophets, you know, because they were murdered by the people, all that blood, you know, all that guilt is going to be put on this generation. Which generation? The generation that he's talking to, right? Like the ones that are right in front of him. And why does he say that? Why is it this generation? And here's why. Because, yes, it was their fathers who were responsible for killing the prophets of old, but who were they prophesying about? Jesus. And who is this generation going to kill themselves? They're going to kill the apostles and those who also prophesy about who? About Jesus. But not before killing who? Jesus, the author of life. Jesus is the one who sent out all of the prophets and all of the apostles. And so when you kill the one who sends out all of them, it all falls back on you. They were the ones who sentenced Jesus to death. And remember, in what we saw a couple, you know, like a chapter back, man. Luke 10. Remember when Jesus sent out the 72, and Jesus, he pronounced woes to the cities that rejected the 72. So in Luke 10, verse 12, he says, I tell you, it will be more bearable on that day for Sodom than for that town, the town that rejected the message of Jesus and the good news of the kingdom of God. Why would the judgment be worse for that town that rejected the message of Jesus than for Sodom? Because they had more than Sodom did. They had far more. And the same is true here. This generation, they had more than every other generation. And while they say, oh, well, you know, we wouldn't have killed the fathers of old if we were there. Like, we recognize that they made the mistake and they shouldn't have killed the prophets that God sent. But what do they turn around and do? They kill the apostles, they kill those who prophesy about Jesus, and they kill the one who sent them all. So of course they would have killed the prophets then too. They were no better than their fathers. And then the last woe, verse 52. Woe to you lawyers, for you have taken away the key of knowledge. You did not enter yourselves, and you hinder those who were entering. And so how ironic it is that the teachers of the law, right, they couldn't fulfill the law themselves. But you know what they say, those who can't do, they teach, right? But the thing is, not only could they not
fulfill the law. They couldn't do the law. They also couldn't teach the law very well. They did it poorly. They did it wrong. In fact, they hindered people. But again, that's just what legalism does. It hinders people from truly knowing God. The legalists, they say, you got to do these things. You got to do, and then you're going to be right with God. But consider, again, what Matthew says in chapter 7, 22 through 23. Familiar passage. He says, on that day, Jesus is speaking here, and he's talking about the last day, the day of judgment. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do many mighty works in your name? I mean, it sounds like they did a lot of things. They did. They did good things. Verse 23, and then will I declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. And so you can actually do a whole bunch of good things and never actually know God. The legalists, they're going to tell you it's all about what you do. But Jesus says, no, that's not it at all. It's all about who you know. If you know me, you know the Father. If you recognize me, if you don't deny me before man, then I will not deny you before my Heavenly Father. It's all about who you know. It's about recognizing that Jesus is Lord, and we lay our lives down at his feet. That's what it's about. Verse 53, as he went away from there, the scribes and the Pharisees, they began to press him hard and to provoke him to speak about many things, lying in wait for him to catch him in something he might say. Do you see already? We've already been seeing it, but we see it more and more that the Pharisees and the religious leaders of the day, I mean, they're just getting stirred up more and more, and it's leading to this day. It's leading to this week. It's leading to this Palm Sunday. It's leading to this coming Good Friday, and it's leading to the coming Resurrection Sunday where all of our hope lies. But continuing on, we're actually going to read we're going to spill over into chapter 12. So chapter 12, verse 1, in the meantime, when so many thousands of people had gathered together that they were trampling one another, he began to say to his disciples first, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy. Nothing is covered up that will not be revealed or hidden that will not be known. Therefore, whatever you have said in the dark shall be heard in the light, and what you have whispered in private rooms shall be proclaimed on the housetops. So Jesus, he's left the dinner party, and many people, they're coming in and they're surrounding him, and they're coming in to hear him teach. And he turns to his disciples and he says, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees. Leaven is a common biblical picture for sin. That's what it means. And what is the specific leaven, the specific sin that Jesus is talking about? Hypocrisy. So bringing back my awesome golfing illustration, I don't have that many the illustrations because my brain doesn't think that way, but when I do, I mean, I really use it. So I have this golfing illustration. Bring that back. Remember, you're decked out in Callaway gear, Callaway apparel, and you look like a professional, but you stink at golf. You have no idea what you're doing. And you went out on your own. No one's around. You went out on your own and you played a terrible round of golf. You shot 40 over par. But that's not what you tell people. No. People say, hey, how'd you do? How'd you shoot? And you say, I shot par. And if you know anything about golf, like real golf, this isn't mini golf, this is real golf. If you know anything about golf, par is extremely difficult to do. Like if you shoot par, like you literally can be on the PGA Tour. Like that's how good it is. So bringing this to the Christian life, you know, we leave here, and so many of us, I mean, we go this way and that way, and sometimes we don't have a whole lot of accountability around us, and people don't see how we live the rest of the days of the week. And, you know, all week long, You were hitting out of the rough and out of the woods, and you never even saw the fairway. You committed so many sins, and you spent absolutely no time with God, but then you come to church, you know, next Sunday, following Sunday, and people are like, hey, man, how's it going? And you're like, oh, great. Never better. God's so good. He's been revealing so many things to me. Like, you know, like me and God, like we've just been spending so much time together. That's hypocrisy. That's fake. And you may think that you can hide it. You may think you can hide it from God, but you can't. You can hide it from the world, but you can't hide it from God. And as soon as you bring a friend with you to go golfing, what's going to happen? They're going to be like, man, you having an off day? I thought you shot par. And be like, yeah, it's windy, you know. No, your golfing skills are going to be exposed. You're a hypocrite. You're a liar. And that's what much of the world sees and views. That's how much of the world sees and views Christians, right? As hypocrites. They go, I'm not going to go to church. They're just that place is full of hypocrites. And in a sense, they're right. Like, we need to be honest and we need to address the fact that we have all at times been hypocrites at one time or another. But if that person who claims that the church is full of hypocrites, if they were to come and actually stay for a little while and hang out with us and listen to the things that we say, do you know what they would realize? You know what they would see? They would see that, yes, we absolutely believe the Bible. We believe in keeping, you know, these biblical moral values. But we also freely admit that we will never be able to perfectly live up to any of it. We humbly admit that without the power of God and with the Holy Spirit working in our lives, there is no way that we can ever live up to God and His commands or His moral values. In other words, we see that we fall short. We know that we fall short, and we don't hide the fact that we fall short. In fact, we actually proclaim it. We all say, I fall short of the glory of God, and that is not hypocrisy. That is honesty. And the honest truth is that without Jesus, I will never be able to stand justified before God. And that is why I trust in Jesus, who fulfilled the law of God for me, who died in my place, and He rose again on the third day. And now He freely offers me His righteousness, not mine, it's His. And He applies it to me so that I may live. That's the gospel. It is earned. It is eternal life earned by another, freely given to us. Jesus Christ, our salvation. And so I'm going to close now. And I must say, as I was studying this passage, I thought, you know, going back to the dinner with the Pharisees, I thought, you know, Jesus, well, He was invited over to dinner, but I don't think they actually ever got around to eating anything. Because the dinner blew up at the very start. Like, Jesus, you know, He didn't wash His hands, and they all freaked out. And I think everyone went away hungry. But Jesus probably went away satisfied and filled, knowing He did the work of His Father in heaven. He said the difficult things. And so if there is sin that needs to be dealt with, let us not feast and ignore our problems. Let us come to the cross, lamenting over our sin in prayer and in fasting and seeking to be restored in our hearts from our sin that has been corrupting us. Yes, the sin that has been corrupting us. We are saved by grace, and that will never change as long as we cling to Jesus. But on this side of heaven, our bodies are still, they still remain corrupted with sin, and that needs to be dealt with and surrendered over to Jesus all the time, letting His Holy Spirit lead us into righteousness as we continue to pursue Jesus through his word and through prayer. Right? Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your word. It was a difficult word to hear this morning, we admit. But the gospel is difficult to hear. It is offensive to the sinner. And yet it is our glorious hope. Lord, we thank you for coming to die. And Lord, as this week, as we remember this holy week, and we look forward to Good Friday and Resurrection Sunday, Lord, just I pray that you would just bless all of us, and that we would that your word this morning, these woes would hit us and convict us where we need conviction, and that we wouldn't hide these things, but we would just lay them down at your feet, Lord, and begin working on us, that we admit our weaknesses, that we admit that we fall short, and we admit that we need you more than anything. Lord, help us become more and more like you and less like ourselves, like Pharisees. Let us be less like the sinners we once were and be more like you, who is perfect and holy and just in everything that he does. Lord, help us love other people. Help us be other people focused. Help us recognize our mission as a people of God, knowing that we are your ambassadors, the lights in the world, Lord, pointing them to you. Lord, we need your help to do all those things. We can't do any of it without you. Apart from you, we can do nothing. So, Lord, we lift you up. We exalt you. We thank you. We give you all the glory. And, Lord, help us respond now as we sing praise to you. And help us give. Help us be generous, Lord. As the ushers come forward, help us give out of generous hearts, not out of obligation or shame or pressure or anything like that, but just out of what every person has decided to give in their hearts. Let that person give. And let it be genuine, and let it be an act of worship, an act of sacrificial worship to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
One day you'll make everything new, Jesus. One day you will bind every wound. The former things shall all pass away. No more tears. And one day you'll make sense of it all. One day every question resolved, and every anxious thought left behind, no more fear. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We'll sing and shout the victory. One day we will see face to face. In a moment we shall be changed on that day. And one day we'll be free, free indeed, Jesus. And one day all the struggle will cease. To heaven. day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We'll sing and shout the victory when we all get to heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We'll sing and shout the victory.
Okay, thank you for being here this morning. Just a reminder, blood drive. Sign up for it. I know I'm a pest, but I need you guys to sign up for it. It's Thursday, 2 p.m. to 6 p.m. If you can be there, great. If not, don't feel bad. And the Tucker, is he here today? I haven't seen him. So whoever wants to volunteer. Travis is going to volunteer. Remember, we have Bible study tonight at 6 p.m. So, thank you.
Everybody want to bow with me, please? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for allowing us to be here in your house today, be able to learn more about you, be able to study your word. Just ask that you allow us to take away what you would have us to take away from what we heard, be able to apply it to our daily lives. Please allow us to also just avoid the things that the Pharisees and the lawyers did, just not adding to or taking away from your word, just being able to realize the truth of it and be able to glorify you in the process of sharing your word with others. In your precious name we pray. Amen.